Good morning, YouTube. This is a pretty good story here you need to read. I've put a lot of stuff together today. I've got a lot of things to do today, so I won't be in and out. I'll be in and out today, so I won't be making too many videos. So I put a bunch of different clips together here for you. Hope you enjoy them, and I hope you enjoy this clip here because it's real important to get the information out so people will know that people are trying, which gives us more strength and more power. Much love to everybody, and let's get the message out, record it, process it, get it out somehow, no matter what. God bless.
But we have to pass the bill so that you can find out what is in it and find out what is in it away from the fog of the controversy.
No good and well that someday there could be a government in power that is shipping its citizens off for disagreements. There are laws on the books now that characterize who might be a terrorist. Someone missing fingers on their hands is a suspect, according to the Department of Justice. Someone who has guns, someone who has ammunition that is weatherproofed, someone who has more than 7 days of food in their house can be considered a potential terrorist. If you are suspected by these activities, do you want to have the government have the ability to send you to Guantanamo Bay for indefinite detention? A suspect, we're not talking about someone who has been tried and found guilty. We're talking about someone suspected of activities. But some of the things that make you suspicious of terrorism are having food, having more than 7 days of food, missing fingers on your hand, having ammunition, having weatherproofed ammunition, having several guns at your house. Is that enough? Are you willing to sacrifice your freedom for liberty? I would argue that we should strike these detaining provisions from this bill because we are giving up our liberty. We are giving up the constitutional right to have due process before we're sent to a prison. This is very important. I think this is a constitutional liberty we should not look at and blindly sign away to the executive power or to the military. So I would call for support of the amendment that will strike the provisions on keeping detainees indefinitely, particularly the fact that we could now, for the first time, send American citizens to prisons abroad. I think that is a grave danger to our constitutional liberty, and I advise a vote to strike these provisions from the bill. Under the provisions, would it be possible that an American citizen then could be declared an enemy combatant and sent to Guantanamo Bay and detained indefinitely?
I think that as long as that individual, no matter who they are, if they pose a threat to the security of the United States of America, should not be allowed to continue that threat.
And I wonder whether the senator is familiar with the fact that the language which precluded the application of Section 1031 to American citizens was in the bill that we originally approved in the Armed Services Committee, and the administration asked us to remove the language which says that U.S. citizens and lawful residents would not be subject to this section. Is the senator familiar with the fact that it was the administration that asked us to remove the very language which we had in the bill which passed the committee, and that we removed it at the request of the administration that would have said that this determination would not apply to U.S. citizens and lawful residents? I'm just wondering, is the senator familiar with the fact that it was the administration which asked us to remove the very language, the absence of which is now objected to by the senator from Illinois?
I'm familiar now because the senator from Michigan has shared that fact with me.
As American citizens thinking about helping Al-Qaeda, please know what will come your way. Death, detention, prosecution. And when they say, I want my lawyer, you tell them, shut up.
You're time to fix your lawyer.
You're an enemy combatant, and we're going to talk to you about why you joined Al-Qaeda.
More frustration and outrage, a desert underwater, as the I-Team continues its week-long look into the devastating impact the housing crisis has had here in the Valley. George Knapp uncovers why many of you may be mistaken if you think that you own your own home. Dave sat down with him for a preview of tonight's story.
This series has been very interesting. Tonight, you turn your focus onto the banks.
It's sort of been a cavalcade of misery, Dave, if you've been watching it all week. The terrible toll that it's exacted on our community, more so than anywhere else, but everyone's been affected. Your home values have gone down 58%. Mine have as well. 63% of the people live here underwater. And it wasn't an accident. This is systemic. This is systematic. The politicians took money from the banks. They deregulated the banks. They got out of the way. The banks said they were going to streamline this whole process. They privatized it, took it out of the hands of county recorders, and started cranking out this mountain of fake documents. Robo-signers, mystery signers, documents that were filed out of order. The result is that millions of people out there, including many tens of thousands of people in our community, people listening to this right now, think they own their homes. They don't. If you bought a house out of foreclosure, even if you bought it from a flipper who got it out of foreclosure, there's a pretty good chance that there is a problem in the chain of the title and that you may not own the home that you've been paying on.
So what do we learn about the bank tonight?
Well, the banks have put this into the hands of these service providers, these third-party people who will handle all the paperwork. And they have done this blizzard of fake paperwork, signing documents that they have no right to sign, using fake names, fake titles, and the result is that every day in this community, people wake up and they realize, I don't own my home. I've been paying on this thing for years. I've been paying it to a mortgage company that does not itself own my home. And it is a shocking thing, and it happened to me as I'm in the middle of this interview with a lawyer telling me this. She says, 9 out of 10 foreclosure homes have a problem. I said, oh, come on. I don't believe that. Look, I bought a home out of foreclosure.
Right.
She says, give me your address. And I gave her the address, and she runs it. It takes her 2 minutes. She goes, bam, there's your problem right there. And it turns out the house I bought 3 years ago and have been paying on, I do not own. And I don't know how we're going to fix it.
Who's going to be able to sleep after they see your story tonight?
Well, I hope people will watch it, and I hope people really get angry about it, because that's what it's going to take, is for everybody to get involved in this and get really ticked off.
Okay. The banks tonight. We'll see you at 11.
All right.
Thanks, George.
listen to this one and ask yourself, why is no one covering this story? There is a fake bond scam. We think two middle-aged Japanese men reportedly caught trying to cross from Italy into Switzerland with $134 billion in bonds. $134 billion, remember that number. It presents two possibilities. Both are really bad. Either they're fake, which means people are trying to flood the market with fake cash, and it's probably a country doing that, because remember, bonds are the same as cash. Or worse, it's real, and some country, some sovereign fund, is trying to quietly dump their reserves. It would have to be a country if they're real, because nobody has this much money. That is 1% of our GDP. With me now is Joe Wiesenthal. He is Wiesenthal. He is the editor of BusinessInsider.com. Joe, you surprised this isn't everywhere?
I'm stunned. It's a really interesting story. Either of the scenarios you suggest, real or fake, I just wish there were more talk about it. I wish the Treasury would talk about it, or some of the mainstream press would go after them for some answers.
We just got no comment from the Treasury Department. They said that we have received your question about U.S. bonds. We've received a question about U.S. bonds seized at the Italian border. These bonds are evidence in an ongoing investigation. We will not be able to comment at this time. Sorry, we can't be of more help, U.S. Treasury. $134 billion of bonds. Can we put the chart up on which countries have that much? Here are the top foreign holders of U.S. Treasuries. China, $763 billion. Japan, $685 billion. United Kingdom, $152 billion. Russia, $137 billion. The value of the smuggled bonds, $134 billion. That's gigantic sums of money.
Either way, it's an incredible scale, whether it's a government dumping some of their holdings or if it's a counterfeit operation. It's unlike anything we've ever seen, not just in size, but also sophistication. The fact that it's this long before they can just dismiss them as being fake or say these are real.
Right. So who would have the technology to fake that? Would that be North Korea?
I would imagine any government that prints currency could probably procure a printer, you know, extremely high quality printer.
Right. So this would be you think it only possibly a government would be able to do this?
It would be the kind of technology that you would expect only a government to have.
Okay. And if they are real, this is what people...
Well, every day the market wakes up to some news of someone in Russia or China or Japan making some comment on the dollar. Either they're getting nervous about holding it, or some days they come out and say they're confident in the dollar. But the market's completely on edge on this question. Will foreign governments keep buying our debt? So if it is real, and if there is a foreign government that's sort of secretly trying to dump some of their dollar holdings, that's a big story. That really tips the story in one direction.
Apparently these bonds are old, and they come from the 50s and 60s.
Well, that's one of the questions that makes people question its veracity. These types of bonds, Kennedy bonds, supposedly would be issued in the 50s or 60s. The reason that they were, $500 million face value bond, it's almost hard to believe that we ever issued those. Apparently the reason was, you know, they're bearer bonds. You have to send in a coupon and collect the money. Well, if you're borrowing a lot of money, you want to have huge coupons, because otherwise it's just too much of a pain to keep sending them in. There were some reports that said the date on the bond was from 1934. That would lend credence to the idea that it's some sort of counterfeit fraud operation.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll follow this, because one way or another, it's not good. Somebody is trying to print mass amounts of our money, and which would be, well, our Fed is doing it, our Treasury is doing it. Why not everybody? And the other is, people are starting to tire of our nonsense here.
These last few clips was just a reminder of everything that's going on, folks. There's more than one thing. But the ones that are at the very front, that's a major deal for all Americans. So you all need to get together, stand up, and let's fight this. Get the message out. Work hard to get the message out. Every friend you got, pass the message. Put the fear of God in their ass where it belongs, because they are not on your side. Not one little iota. God bless.